It's a pleasure to be here, and I would like to tell you about the development of a particular family of computers. And I would like to propose a name for this family. I'd like to call them Turing computers. This has nothing to do with Turing machines. And so if you will listen, and I hope I will convince you that this is a good title for the kind of machines we're talking about. When I arrived in England, I went to work in this house. This was Teddington Hall, and the mathematics division occupied this house and the one just to the right of it. And we worked upstairs in that room, and the person that I worked for at that point was Turing. He actually wasn't there when I arrived. He'd come to the United States for a conference. And so the people that I met was Wilkinson and Woodyer, who were working on the ideas for the computer that was to be built there. And I was lucky in another respect that one of the things that Mr. Womersley, who was superintendent of the mathematics division, was he promptly sent me off on a visit to Cambridge and to Manchester to see what kind of computing activity was going on there. And in the course of, by February or so of that year, I had produced a report which briefly described the status of the various computer projects in the United States and in England. And the situation at that time was there was the project at the Moore School to build the EDVAC. There was the people at the Institute for Advanced Study who were beginning to plan the machine there that was to be based on the Selectron. The people at MIT had not yet turned to a digital computer. They were working on an analog computer to do simulation of aircraft and things of that sort. In England, Professor Wilkes was working on delay lines to build a delay line style computer, and Professor Williams at Manchester was working on the cathode ray tube in which he planned to store information for his particular computer. There was also activity at Dulles Hill. This was by Mr. Flowers and Coombs and so on, who worked for the post office. And long since I learned that they had been active at Bletchley Park in the building of Colossus, which was used in the cryptographic activity during the war. But in 1947 at NPL, there was no word at all about what they had been doing or about how Turing had been involved in that particular project. In fact, the story about Turing was that during the war, he had worked on a communication system, a sort of skip frequency device, which had some random number generator in the transmitter and a number of flip-flops, which would take up combinations of binary bits in a random fashion. And depending on the value of those bits would transmit on different frequencies. So that whenever you wanted to send a message, then you would transmit a little bit of it on one frequency, then change the frequency and transmit a little bit on another one and so on. The idea was that the listener would not be able to get more than rare pieces of your communication, would not be able to tell what you were saying. The receiver was to be synchronized and would skip these frequencies in unison with the transmitting device, and it would receive the complete message. So that was the kind of project that I had heard that Turing had worked on. Some people said it was not successful. I'm not sure he worked on it, and I'm not sure the reason that these people said it was not successful. But there was another project that he worked on somewhat before I arrived. And again, this is perhaps a story and maybe not true, so I think you take it as a story. And that is, he was trying to experiment with a delay line with the idea of using this in a computer. Well, the easiest kind of delay line to make was to use a piece of sewer pipe, which in England is about 20 foot long, and he'd put a microphone at each end and transmitted a sound wave in one end and hoped to pick it up at the other end. The story was he'd burn out the microphones, and it was not a particularly successful experiment. Well, anyway, that's the story about Turing as I heard it those days. Now, let's talk a little bit more about the project. In actual fact, the project at NPL was purely a logical design and programming project. In all other computer projects that I know about, there was a combination of a logical design, circuit design, and the idea of putting together a complete computer. But at NPL, in the mathematics division, there was no one working on the hardware side of the job. The reasons behind this, I learned a little bit later that Mr. Womersley had corresponded with Professor Wilkes and Professor Williams at Manchester, and there had been some discussion about joint projects and so on. And up in April of 1947 or so on, there was finally a sort of a decision that each one of the groups would go their own way. Professor Wilkes would build his computer, and Professor Williams would build his, and NPL would do something. Well, there was work going on at the post office at Dollis Hill in terms of building the ley line memory. This was going pretty slow, though, but we went up to visit it on occasion, and I'm sure that some of you at least have heard of Wilkinson's description of how we went up to the post office. Turing happened to be a long-distance runner, so he liked to run up to Dollis Hill. That was 16 miles. None of the rest of us was up to that. So Wilkinson, when he went up with Turing, rode his bicycle and took along in a briefcase or something clothes so Turing could change at the gate before we went into the meeting. Well, the time came when I was to go up to Dollis Hill with Turing, and the question was, you know, how would we race? Well, the decision was I would take the train up. And the difficulty, or what makes it a more of a competitive affair, is that I had to change twice. So, for example, I started at Teddington, and you start in towards London, and a place called Clapham Junction, you change to a circular train, and that goes around to the north side of London. Then there you change to still another train and go out to Dollis Hill. And it turned out that I beat Turing by about 5 minutes, you see. So, Well, anyway, moving on to the work that was going on there, I draw this picture of an adder, or I show you this picture of an adder, and it's fairly simple to understand, but there's two significant points here. One is that all this logical design was done on the basis of just the logical requirements. There was no consideration of what kind of logical elements one might use to accomplish gates like this. So, for example, if you take the circle up there with the 3 in it, that says that that gate will put out a signal if all 3 inputs are present. The one that says 2 will put out a signal if any 2 of the 3 or all 3 inputs are present. The bottom one with no signal in it really corresponds to a default 1, and it puts out a signal if there's a signal on any one of the so-called stimulating inputs and no signal on the inhibiting input with a little smaller circle there. The inhibiting signal will override, so if that's present, then no matter what's on the other 3 lines, there will be no signal out. Now, if you look at the inputs over there, there's two normal inputs, A, B, and there's a carry that comes around the top. That little triangle stands for a 1 pulse time delay, and you'll see that this really does produce a nice representation of a binary adder. But at this time, the kinds of logical elements we had available, there was no transistors, there were no diodes that anybody would dare use, and in fact, in the ENIAC, for example, we used so-called dual grid vacuum tubes. These were tubes in which there were 2 control grids, well, really 1 control grid and a second grid. The first grid determined whether electrons were emitted from the cathode or not, and the second grid determined whether these electrons went to a screen or went to the plate. And depending on the combination of the two inputs then, you could control whether the electrons flowed to the plate if both grids were high. So this gave you a logical AND device. And and just two inputs, and that was it. So if you wanted a three-input device, for example, you had to make it up out of a combination of these. And some people really didn't like to use these tubes. These are more complicated than a normal vacuum tube, and perhaps life and reliability was more of a question. So in any case, it was fairly difficult to put together even a simple device like this binary adder. You may notice there's an inhibition signal that comes in from the right up there that suppresses the carry, so that whenever you want to, you can prevent the carry from circulating. The idea is that you would pass information through this adder doing a word time, which might be 32 bits, for example, and then you could suppress the carry so that whatever happened the next following word time was not influenced by what went on this particular word time. To give you a feeling of one contrast here relative to Turing, I would like to reproduce the corresponding adder that's described in the report that he had produced prior to this year. This was in his proposal to build a computer at NPL. And here you find, if you really work this out, and it's much more difficult to easily see what goes on, you find that it really accomplishes essentially the same task. The suppression of the carry and the output is handled a little bit differently, but that's really all. And I think, in my experience, that it was characteristic of Turing to, you know, put together circuits like this that were not really the easiest to understand. But you know, they were correct and they worked when you really dug in there. But you had to work on it. It's interesting that, and really, we should hear from the expert here, Professor Wilkes, because it. Just prior to 1947, there was correspondence between Mr. Womersley and Professor Wilkes about building a computer at 4 MPL. And Professor Wilkes produced a proposal in which he said, this is a very simple design. He spelled out some of the details, and this was sent to Womersley, who referred it to Turing for comment. And Turing's comment was that it was not simple enough and didn't do enough. And, not really sure that he looked at it close enough to be sure, but I think his mind may have been almost made up in advance. But anyway, Turing looked upon his computer as being simpler in its logical structure. And at these times, of course, when logical devices were costly, you know, in terms of how many elements you had to have to produce a given function, or to produce a flip-flop that would store one bit of information and so on. Simplicity of design was a very significant point. All right, so now we're going to take a look at the ACE computer as it developed at NPL. And there's really three versions of this, perhaps four versions, but at least three anyway, and we'll see how that works out. The first of these has become called the ACE test assembly. This all came about in the spring of 1947 because group of us who were working on the computer there in the mathematics division, with perhaps the exception of Turing, were disappointed that things weren't moving ahead. We weren't going to have a computer very soon. So we proposed, okay, let's build a simplified version of the ACE, and so that we can get it done quickly and see how it works and so forth. I think Turing was much more interested in building what I would call the big ACE, and which ultimately was built at NPL. And in fact, all the planning that went on early in 1947 was really with respect to this big ACE. But anyway, we managed to get Womersley to approve developing the small test assembly, as it was called, and Turing didn't particularly object. I'm not sure he was real excited about doing, because he was really interested in ultimately getting the big machine written. And there's a wonderful letter that he wrote to Ross Ashby saying, you know, it would be nice to come to NPL and participate in this computer development. And it was sort of a necessary evil that this device would have to do some computing for other people. But questions of artificial intelligence could perhaps be worked on in between the normal computation. Okay, let's go on to look at this diagram. And this effectively characterizes the ACE-type computer in that you think of a number of memory elements. Let me just pick up my pointer here. And I'm pointing the wrong way. Right, there we are. Okay, so you have memory elements such as a block like this, and the information from this line will circulate around a loop here. So that in the ACE conception, this was a mercury delay line that would store about 1,000 pulses. In fact, most people talked in terms of 32 numbers, each 32 bits long, because 32 bits is approximately a 10 decimal digit number. And a 10 decimal digit number was the kind of size number that most people thought was important in computation at that time. So you have a number of circulating units like this. So you have long lines like the one up here that would be 1,024 bits. And you have short lines like this one that would maybe be 32 bits. And all operations in this computer was a matter of transferring from some line around through the highway system to some destination. So what actually happened depended upon what source number you picked and what destination you chose. So for example, arithmetic was done by sending, you know, a clearing add would be a matter of just sending the new number to the storage unit through the adder, perhaps, as illustrated here. If you wanted to add a number to what was in the accumulator, that would be a matter of sending it to this destination. And still a third destination would have an inverter on it, so that the bits that came from there would be inverted or changed sign, so that you added or subtracted by sending the number either to one destination or to the other destination. And then if you wanted to store this information, that was a matter of choosing this as a source and sending it back to any place in memory that you like. And since all the various elements were either were connected to the source or the destination switch in this form, if you wanted to transfer information from one long line to another long line, then it had to occur in the same word position in that line. So for example, you could copy a number from position 13 of long line 1 to position 13 of long line 5, for example, but not to other positions in those lines. That's not quite true, but we'll get to that in a moment. If you wanted to transfer it to a different time position in the line, then you had to first transfer it into a one-word storage, and then as a separate operation, transfer it someplace else. You might characterize this as sort of distributed computing, because the logic here is it's the operations are spread around on this on the source switch or the destination switch. Here's an interesting example down here. We have a storage unit, but we have an extra delay out here. So if we choose this particular place, we'll get the information here delayed by appropriate amount. And in fact, in the ACE pattern, there was typically a long line with an associated one-word delay of this sort, which would allow you to precess the information. In other words, if a word was in position 13, you could easily move it down to position 14 and so on. And in fact, what you could actually do by, as we'll see a few moments later, is to develop a queuing system, a first in, first out queue in which information is moved in the queue in the appropriate fashion. And this is one of the characteristics of all the versions of the ACE computer. Okay, if we go on and look at this diagram, I hope you can see it better than I can, but in effect, We don't really need to worry about details, but this shows quite a number of lines associated with the source and the destination switch. And in fact, the list of sources and destinations almost completely characterizes one of these ACE computers. If we look at the other half, there's actually 32 sources and destinations in the ACE test assembly or in the pilot modeled version. And some of these are logical combinations of other lines. In fact, let's move on to this diagram. This has come from a report that Woodger was producing late in 1947 and sort of illustrates how the development went. There was a proposed structure for sources or destination, and this logical combinations here were typical of what went on. So for example, you have a certain one-word temporary storage, and then here's the negation of that, or the complement, bit-by-bit complement of that particular value. Here's the bits whenever TS9 and TS10 are not equal, then you get a bit out of this particular source. Here's another similar one. I can't actually read the symbol there. Maybe you can. And so on. And down here, for example, is TS9 delayed one bit. That effectively multiplies the number by two. Here we see destinations over here in which you can send information to this temporary storage or to a particular flip-flop. And in fact, there were two flip-flops at this time. And the scratched-out portion shows that by virtue of the amount of programming that had been done up to that point, that particular destination was not useful. At this stage of the game, in the development of the so-called ACE test assembly, the powers that be at NPL, and this was Sir Charles Darwin, which is a grandson of the Darwin that most of you know about, in effect decided that these people in the mathematics division didn't really know how to build computers. He didn't know how right he was, by the way, because none of us had had any electronics experience. My degree is in mathematics. My experience in electronics was writing manuals for the ENIAC, and you can write manuals without knowing electronics. And I think I had more electronics experience than any of the other people in the mathematics division. So there's no doubt that Sir Charles was exactly right in his decision, but we certainly felt very bad about the decision, because what he decided was that the computer really should be made by the people in the electronics division, because they knew about circuits and things of that sort, and they can make delay lines that would work and so forth. And at this stage of the game, we were quite disappointed, and doing this transition while the electronics division was coming up to speed and trying to decide whether this device that had been worked out by these mathematicians was really the kind of computer that should be made and so on, this caused a lot of time. And you should look at their side of the game too. Here was a computer that was quite different from anything that anybody else was doing. Professor Wilkes was doing something quite different at Cambridge. Professor Williams was doing something else. The people in the United States were working on logical designs that was not at all like this. So they certainly had a right to think that these mathematicians might very well not know what they were doing. Well, in this interim then, while all this was boiling around and the people, the activity at NPL was sort of up in the air, I worked on a 12-bit version of this ACE computer. When we talked about the ACE test assembly, Mr. Womersley and so on always spoke of it as a device to test out the ideas and so on. It wasn't necessarily supposed to do computing, but we had different ideas. When we put this together, we were going to make something that computed. But this 12-bit version that I worked on at that time was certainly small enough, the words were short enough, and the amount of memory and so on that you could address was small enough that this would not really be a practical computer. And in fact, many of the logical features that are in the 32-bit source and destination structure is not on this particular one, which had only 8 sources and 8 destinations. But the same general technique was involved here in terms of transferring information around. And here we see a picture of the control circuitry. Here's a 12-bit register. The information circulates around through an adder. And whenever there's a carry at the end of the word time, that triggers a transfer and so on. And this structure then could execute a sequence of commands, but certainly not anything that would do significant computation. Well, this was getting towards the end of the year, and I went back to the United States in December of 1948. I'd already managed to get a job at the Bureau of Standards to go to work out at UCLA at a place called the Institute for Numerical Analysis. In fact, we had decided that we wanted to settle in California. We'd lived in Philadelphia for 3 years and decided that that kind of climate was not for us. So when I accepted the job at the Bureau of Standards, it was on the condition that I would work in Los Angeles. Well, John Curtis, who ran the mathematics division at NBS at that time, said, okay, but come spend about 6 weeks at the Bureau in Washington so you find out how the place works. Well, that seemed reasonable. So we came to Washington and got involved in the Bureau's activity to acquire a computer for the Census Bureau. And they were negotiating with Eckert and Mauchly and trying to figure out how to write a contract that would help Eckert and Mauchly financially so they could get this computer put together and so forth. And in the spring of 1948, the people at the Bureau were becoming a little bit disappointed that computers were not being completed as soon as they would like. So finally, there was a decision that the Bureau should go ahead and build a computer. So I proposed to him, well, why don't we build a computer like the ACE? Well, that didn't go over very well, although I tried to produce some designs and tell them what a wonderful computer this was and so forth. But I think the fact that I was supposed to go out to California sort of was a factor against the accepting of this particular proposal. And then what happened is Sam Lubkin, who had worked on the EDVAC development at the Moore School, came to work for the Bureau. And so that made the decision. And the computer that was built in Washington then followed fairly closely the development plans for the EDVAC at the University of Pennsylvania. Well, my 6 week stay in Washington stretched out for almost a year. And finally, in December of 48, I went out to UCLA and started a computer called the National Bureau of Standards Western Automatic Computer. But I was always interested in this idea of being able to pick up numbers when you wanted them and to put the next instruction so that you could get the maximum speed out of a cyclic memory of the sort that we've been looking at here. Now, to see a little bit more about this, let's go back to the pilot model ACE and look at this instruction. And you'll find that there are various components in here. There's a source and destination, and there's a timing number and a next instruction timing number. And the idea is that the source and the destination are connected together, and depending upon the timing number, that determines when the actual transfer will take place. So if you wanted to pick up word 13 out of line 5, the source will be 5. The timing number will be such that at word time 13, this action is triggered, and the information comes out on what was called the highway. We tend to use the word bus in this country, but the British at that time used the word highway. And then depending upon the destination, it was sent to some particular location. After that happened, then depending upon the next instruction timing number, and the instruction was picked out of a place specified by that number and read into the control circuitry and caused that particular action. Now, this represents a means of transferring one word from someplace in the long lines to the accumulator, or from the accumulator to someplace in the long lines, or if you want to transfer from one line to another, it has to be in the corresponding position. If we go on and look at the control circuitry, it's all shown here. Here's the 32-word instruction register, and the addition here is very simple, of course. You're simply adding one, two numbers so that it takes only a half adder. You don't have to have a complete adder. And the various flip-flops, we won't go into the details here, but the control is fairly simple. Ultimately, here's a picture of the delay line, both the short lines and the long line that was used in the ACE development. I'll show you the picture of the machine that was as it was first developed, and then finally, as it was dressed up a bit with a sign along the top. And this particular machine was produced commercially under the name of the Deuce. And I discovered here that there's a member of the audience who spoke to you a few moments ago that actually programmed on it, so he knows more about the Deuce than I do. But in any case, the people at MPL continued to be interested in the so-called Big Ace. And here we see some specifications of what the Big Ace was to have in terms of memory. The actual long lines, there were to be 24 lines of 32 numbers each. There were to be five lines of four numbers each, four with two, and seven of them with one line. So you had various hierarchy of memory in this system, and you could transfer information from locations in any of these lines to locations in the corresponding timing position of any of the other lines. So actually, the Big Ace, as it was called, did not really have a lot of memory, perhaps even from the point of view of the technology at the time it was built. This information comes from a manual that was dated 1959. The big difference between the Big Ace and the pilot model was that now, instead of having just one source, there were two sources and a destination. And in the highway system, there was the capability of performing various logic functions. And generally, these were in a number of different groups, and in each group there were some eight functions that could be performed. So some of these are arithmetic type operations, some are logic type operations, and also there were shift operations. The instruction now was much more complicated, and I'm not sure how well you can see this, but now there's two sources, A, B, and a function, destination D, a next instruction line, a next instruction timing number, a characteristic that determined whether it was a one-word transfer or a two-word transfer or a four-word transfer. And the number J did not serve any particular function, but depending upon your coding, you could count in this position, and the overflow from this would move into the T value and cause you to pick up an instruction from a different place in the line. So if the next instruction was to be in position 17, for example, then by counting in this J position, when they finally overflowed, then your instruction would come from position 18. So this would give you a conditional branch of control, or a counting capability, that you could count out a certain number of steps and then branch to a different place. There were also a number of destinations that had this function. So for example, there were 64 sources and destinations in this computer, and if you send information to destination 60, and if it was equal to zero, it caused the same kind of extra increment of the T number, so that the instruction came from one place different from what it would normally come from. So in all this ACE family, the conditional transfers of control were all of this type. There was no general branch to some location in memory, but it was a choice between a given location and the location that followed it. This illustrates the possibility of modifying instructions. So there's certain, you can modify the sources and the destination and this J value in various combinations, and this allowed you to carry out this counting operation and indexing values in a particular line in memory. This is a picture of a cathode ray tube in which the contents of one memory line is displayed. And Wilkinson describes the use of this in the solution of systems of linear equations by iterative methods as you look at the less significant bits which might be on this end, and when they stop changing, you know you've converged to the limit. And this allows you to use somewhat unstable methods. There are some methods which tend to converge towards the limit, and then they blow up. And so you very carefully watch this, and when the bits stop changing there, you quick push a button that causes a branch so that you stop the solution at that particular point. And I think that's a unique feature that I've not seen in any other computer. It was not used in the G-15 either. Okay, here we see a picture of the Big Ace as it was installed at NPL in the same building I showed you on the second slide. And now we move on to the computer that you see sitting here, the Bendix G-15. And time-wise, this was developed, by Bendix about 1954. So this was developed before the people at NPL went on to build the Big Ace. We see a block diagram of the system here and the same circulation of information from sources around to a destination. Instructions come off on a separate switch system here. I/O is handled by a special line over here called line 5. The difference here is that in the bus system, in contrast to the pilot model where information was just transferred around, you can invert the number, change its sign, and you could transfer via the accumulator, so that the accumulator is on the source and destination switch in the conventional way, and you add by sending information to one destination, or you subtract by sending information to a different destination. But you could transfer from any one of these, any place, any source, via the accumulator back to any other place. And if you transferred from a long line back to that same position, the long line, you had the effect of making all the words come out to be one word late, just the length of the accumulator. So this allowed you to build up a queue of any length and circulate information through this. So you could put the information in at one end and ultimately it would come out at the other end. To see really how this works, we'll go on to the next slide, which is, I backed up here. Which shows this is a drawing out of one of the Bendix manuals, by the way, which shows the four states. In general, we might start over here where the system is waiting to read an instruction. We're waiting for the drum to rotate to the time when that instruction is available. When the instruction is set up, then we wait until it's time to do the transfer. Then we do the transfer, then we wait for the next instruction, read it, and generally we go around a sequence like this. However, an instruction could be immediate, which meant that it would immediately take effect and would continue to execute until the transfer timing number. So this allowed you to transfer any number of words from one given line to another line, for example. So, and in the Bendix machine, there were 108 words in a line. So you could transfer, you know, words from 30 to 45 from one line to another line with one instruction, or you can transfer a complete line from one place to another. This caused the made it simpler to pick up the instructions only from selected lines. So lines 1 through 5 were available for instructions. If you needed more space from that, you'd store it in lines 6, 7, or 8 and so on, and when you needed them, you transferred them into one of these lines. So this simplified the switching, the size of the switch that was needed to pick up next instructions and so on. And all the other ACE computers had this same kind of immediate possibility. So you could transfer a block of information from one place to another. So for example, if you wanted to sum all the numbers in a line, all you had to do was send it to the accumulator for that appropriate number of times, and you'd have the sum of those numbers. In the case of the G-15, that would be 108 numbers. In the case of the ACE, that was 32 numbers for the long lines. This was typically used to compute checksums, so that whenever you read information in from punch paper tape, as represented by the magazine on the front here, or from magnetic tape or whatever, then with one instruction you could do the sum of those numbers, and if that turned out to be correct, then usually the transfer of information was correct. If we look at the instruction here again, we have this same structure. There's timing numbers here that run from 0 to 107. Instead of using A, B, C, D, and so on for the hexadecimal digits beyond 9, the Bendix system used U, V, W, X, Y, and Z. And so that is the reason for the U7s here. So the timing numbers, either for the transfer or for picking up the next instruction, occupied space like this. There was a characteristic and source and a destination and an unused bit out here. So that generally then, this instruction was set up, that meant some source was connected to some appropriate destination. When the timing number came up, the transfer occurred, and then after that, it would be in the wait instruction state, and when this number came up, then it would pick up the next instruction, and that would complete the cycle. Actually, the Bendix G-15 was more complicated, perhaps, than it should have been, because we felt that it was fairly important that this number be exactly the number of the time that the transfer should occur. But if we go back to the logical design of the control unit, it was designed on a more simple basis, that whenever this number was established in the instruction register, the counting process occurred, and an overflow occurred whenever this number counted up to all ones and then became a zero. And so if you had some particular number in here as a transfer timing number, like 35, for example, overflow would occur with respect to the complement of that number. Well, that would make it difficult to look at an instruction and tell just when it was supposed to transfer. So actually, one extra track was recorded on the drum, in which there were particular numbers stored, which when this was transferred to the instruction register, these numbers were added to it. And the effect of that was to make this overflow at the time that's specified by the actual number. And as I say, that was a complication which perhaps was really really unnecessary, because if you're prepared to code for this kind of a machine, you could have worked out the coding without doing that. If you're going to put an instruction in location 25, it's going to transfer in at time 47, then you subtract these two numbers, you complement, and because of things being a little bit late, you add one to that, and that's the timing number that you put in. You see, that would be the kind of thinking you'd have to do as you write down a particular instruction. If we go on and look at the sources and destinations, I think this is probably a little hard to read, but in general, the G-15 had 20 long lines, each with 108 words in them. It also had 4 forward lines. It had 3 two-word lines and the 1 single-word line, the accumulator. The two-word lines was a double-length accumulator and performed the multiplication and division. The forward lines were simply temporary storage so you could get out information without waiting for all the 108 words to come around. So generally then, it was up to you to manage your information so you'd have it in the faster storage if it was going to be used very often. I've mentioned that there's 108 words in the line. You might wonder why that was so. Well, Bendix had shortly before they embarked upon this project, acquired the Medida activity from Northrop Aviation, and that was a digital differential analyzer. The idea is that you represent numbers by the rate at which pulses occur in a line. And to do that sort of thing, you had a so-called integrator that's represented by the circuitry that we see here. So for example, if you add the Y register and the R register together, then and you watch for overflows, the overflow will occur at a rate that depends on the value of Y. If Y is very large, it'll occur every time. If Y is very small, it will occur almost never. And that rate of from zero pulses per second or per increment of time up to the maximum rate then can be used to represent variables. And with this kind of technique, people at Northrop had built a device that would do differential equations. And the whole circuitry was extremely simple, and there were not many vacuum tubes in it and so on. So one of the things that Bendix wanted to do was to attach this kind of circuitry to selected lines in the G-15, and you could have this differential analyzer running at the same time that the general purpose computer was running, and you could mess with the numbers in the differential analyzer on the fly. I'm not sure anybody did anything constructively by doing that, but it was an interesting concept in any case. The arrangement in the G-15 drum is of some interest. All the information was erased every cycle and rewritten, so it was exactly the analog of the mercury delay line. And in fact, in a path around the drum, you see the information is coming around the drum here. It's red and recorded up there, goes around the drum. So that's the circulation, that's the long circulation path. Along that same path, you have information read here and written here. So that gives you a short four-word line or two-word line or something of that sort. So all the information in the G-15 was stored in this dynamic fashion. If you turned off the machine, everything went away. So whenever you turned it on, the first thing you had to do was to read in your program to get started. There was permanent erase magnets here. This had another advantage, of course, in that the magnetization was from completely from one polarity to the opposite polarity. So it gave you twice the signal that you would be able to get under normal conventional means. There was also another advantage in that there was no fringing effect, which was a problem with drum technology at that particular time. So this made the whole drum design simpler. The signals were twice as large as ordinary, and it took less tubes to do the operation. Well, let's move on here. This is an actual picture of the drum. You could look at it around the other side of the machine here. The drum is behind this cabinet, actually, in there with this covers up the heads. The cover is off here, so if you want to come down and look at them later on, you may. This is the typewriter keyboard. All the control was from this keyboard. So if you wanted to stop, for example, or reload information from the punched paper tape, then certain keys accomplished this. The front panel looked like this. There were just a few indicators to tell what source and what destination was in effect, so you could perhaps tell where you stopped if you stopped the program someplace in the middle. Probably not, because this was not a unique representation of the instruction, much less any information about where it came from. Here's a picture of the front panel. It doesn't look as good as the device. I didn't realize they would have it down here for you to look at. Here's what the plug-in units look like on the side. They're color-coded and keyed, and here's the diode logic in between. Here's what coding looks like. So for example, this is an instruction that does a sequence of five instructions that does a multiplication, but each one has a transfer timing number, a next instruction timing number, a characteristic, a source, and a destination. And whenever you wrote an instruction in some particular location, you checked it off over here so that you're sure you didn't write an instruction in that same place a little bit later. And as I say, it was fairly difficult to work out the proper values to use in these various cases. The characteristic determined whether the number was to be transferred as it was, whether it was to be complemented or negated, whether it was a two-word transfer for double precision, or whether It was this immediate type of transfer of many words at a particular time. Multiplication, for example, you could carry out to any number of bits you wanted because of this immediate instruction. You could run it for 10 word times, 20 word times, or whatever. And the multiplier and the multiplicand were shifted in opposite directions, so it had the effect of producing the product in the proper bit position. So if you stopped at some intermediate place, you knew what the product was in terms of powers of two and so on. Well, people didn't really like to program in this form. And so two gentlemen from the Humble Oil Company, that bought one of the early G-15s, decided that that was not the way to do it. So they wrote up a system called Intercom 101. And I'm happy to announce that if you have any questions, the expert is in the audience. Joe Weizenbaum really polished up the version of Intercom that they wrote here. So this was before he became famous, you see. Well, the point about this intercom and another one, of which their typical instructions here, was that these were floating point systems. Generally, the floating point routines were located in one of these command lines, and the floating point operation would be completed in one major cycle of the memory. So in the 108 word times, you would complete a floating point operation. If the number required extra shifting for normalization, you might miss, but rarely did this happen. So that meant that you could tell the person that if you put the data in this part of memory and you put the instructions in this part of memory, then your program will run faster. And this was the system under which most of the computing on the G-15 was done. I will talk about one other system. This was a system called POGO, which was the fixed point system, which was supposed to be friendly to the user. And in this case, the idea was that you wrote your instructions more or less in the conventional, you know, add this number, store there, and so on. And the software would develop the proper instruction and locate it at the right place in memory so that execution would be at maximum speed. This particular system is somewhat similar to a system called SOAP that was developed for the IBM 650. Well, after this, Bendix decided that maybe they really ought to transistorize the G-15. The maintenance was a fairly substantial problem. These vacuum tubes would become weak and the signals would not be proper. And so there's planning to transistorize this, but in effect that never happened because just about this time magnetic cores were becoming very satisfactory, and it was obvious that that was a much better way to build a computer. So this sort of marked the end of the Turing family of computers. Well, thank you very much for listening to all this.